This is Coding Math, episode 38, Verlet Integration Part 3. In the last couple of episodes, we created a basic physics engine using Verlet integration, with points moving around with physics and forms being created via sticks that constrain the points to certain lengths. Today we'll cover some rendering tweaks that will make the objects we're drawing look a little better. You remember that in order not to have this box collapse, we needed to add a support beam across the corners. Well, we don't really need to see that. There might be some other things like that as you start building out forms, so let's add a way to selectively render certain sticks. We can start just by adding a property to that final stick called hidden and setting it to true. Alternately, we could create a property called visible and set it to true on all the sticks we want to see, but JavaScript makes it easy for us to be lazy. Now, down in render sticks, we can put an if statement just before we render each stick, saying if not s hidden. In other words, we'll only draw the sticks that are not hidden. If a stick does not have a hidden property, it will be null, coerced to false, and then the not operator will make it true and the stick will be drawn. I also want to remove the line to draw points, as we don't really need to see those either. But that has the clear rect line in it, so we need to take that out of there and put it up in the update function so that we can safely comment out render points. And now we have a straight up box, no points, no structural supports. We can take this a step further and add some other properties to the sticks. Let's take the first stick and give it a color property set to red and a width property set to 5. Now we can go down to render sticks again and use these properties to affect how sticks are drawn. Right now there's a single call to begin path and a single call to stroke, which will cause all the sticks to be drawn with the last style and width set. So we'll have to move those calls inside the for loop so that each stick is drawn independently with its own style. Of course, this is a bit less optimized than drawing them all in one batch, but that's the trade-off. Then we can get fancy and use a tertiary operator to see if the stick has a color property. If so, we'll set context.strokeStyle to that color. Otherwise, we'll set it to a default black color. And we'll do the same thing with width. If it exists, we'll use it to set context.lineWidth. If not, we'll default it to 1. Run it. And now our box has a red top. Now at this point we're just drawing sticks, so it's all lines, no way to do a fill. Let's change that. We'll keep our points and sticks, but we'll add another type of object that's just used for rendering. I'll call these forms. We'll start out by making a forms array, and we'll push a single object onto it. A form will have a path, which is an array of points, and a color. The path will just be the 4 points that we already have. And let's give it a color of green. Now we go into update and comment out render sticks and add in a call to render forms. And then we'll jump down to the end and create this function. This will loop through the forms array, getting each form, only one for now. I'll begin a path and set the fill style to the form's color, and then move to the first point in the path. Then I'll do another for loop from index 1 through the rest of the points in the path, and do a line 2 to each one of them. And finally I'll call context fill. Running that, and now we have a green box. Now you have the option to render points, render all sticks or selective sticks, and render forms. We're cooking with gas. Now we have one more big rendering trick. Let's render an image into the box we create. For this, I'll add another array called images, and I'll push an object onto that. This will be very similar to a form with a path of points, but instead of a color, it's going to have an image to draw. Note that for a form, the points could create any path you want, but for an image, they should form a rectangle, ideally with the same aspect ratio as the actual image you're displaying. I'll deal with that in a moment. For the image, we need an HTML image element. I'll set this property to the return value of a function called loadImage, passing it a URL. Now, I'm really going to shortcut this here because loading an image is an asynchronous operation, and I should work out some kind of preloader to make sure the images are loaded before we kick off the action. But I'm going to keep it dangerously simple and just let it load when it loads. Since I'm running this off my hard drive at home, it's pretty fast and will load within a few frames of the animation starting. Don't try this not at home. The loadImage function just creates an image element and sets its source to the URL we passed in and returns that. Now we jump down to update and comment our render forms and add in render images. And we'll create the render images function. This gets a bit wordy, but you should be able to follow along. As usual, we loop through the array and get a reference to each image object. The idea here is that we'll translate the canvas to the top left corner of where we want to render the image. This is point zero. Then we'll figure out the orientation of the box, how much it is rotated. We'll do that by getting the x and y distance from point 0 to point 1, and using Math8Tan2 to find that angle. We'll rotate the context to match that angle. Then we just need to draw the image into the box, using its width and height, which we get by calculating the distance between points 0 and 1, and points 0 and 3. Back in the code, we'll get the width of the box, this is the distance from point 0 to 1, to top points. The height will be the distance from point 0 to 3, the two leftmost points. Dx, which is 0.1x minus 0.0x, and dy, which is 0.1y minus 0.0y. And finally, the angle using Math8Tan2 with dy and dx. With all that done, we're ready to draw. We save the context, translate to point 0, rotate to the angle, and then call draw image. Passing in the image we created with the URL, 0, 0 as a position, and W and H as the width and height. And then we restore the context for next time. That's all, folks. Well, almost all. Right now, our points form a square, but I know that this image is 640 by 480 in size. I'll paste in a new set of points here that create a 320 by 240 rectangle. Same aspect ratio, but half the size of the actual image. And now we have a cat bouncing around with real box physics. Pretty freaking neat, right? Heck, why not throw a sprite sheet in there and get an animated image bouncing around? Now, I hope you've been using the code from the last couple of episodes to make some neat models. This episode should give you some more techniques and new ideas. I'd actually planned to wrap up Verlet integration with this episode, but wound up doing more with rendering than I expected. I have a few more tricks up my sleeve on this stuff, so it looks like we'll get one more Verlet episode next week. See you then.